those of us who lived down at Danville and among the icebergs and the Eskimos, that anyone who left their warm fireside tonight was a rugged individualist in the very best sense of the word. And I want to disarm you right away of the fact that I am a professor. Two months ago, we talked something about the early settlement of the city of Lewiston. Lewistown Plantation. It was probably the only early settlement, perhaps in this state, that had a sawmill before it had settlers. At the time, Colonel Moses Little provided a mill for settlers to be. There were only two permanent settlers in the whole plantation. We noted that following that mill development, and within the next few years, Lewiston became a very prolific producer of lumber. That by 1810, there were no less than five very busy sawmills. There were two grist mills, and the population was still a little under 300. So that at the very outset of Lewiston settlement, it seems clear that it was destined to be a manufacturing community. The fact that it turned to textiles was also indicated very early, because in 1809, Colonel Josiah Little built a fulling and carding mill, one of the first in this area, of course, and there were none anywhere in the state at that time north of the Mayo Mill at Gray, Maine. So that at a very early date, it was clear that Lewiston was destined to be an industrial center. Colonel Little and his associates operated this mill until 1814, when it was destroyed by fire, probably of an incendiary nature. And at the urging of the community, in 1819, rebuilt the mill. And at that time, he brought to Lewiston Dean Fry of Brunswick, a man who had had a great deal of experience in the manufacture of cloth, and who was the ancestor of the Fry family in Lewiston, one of the most prominent families in the city, not only at that time, but in after years. The new mill operated until 1834, when it was converted and looms were brought in for the first time. And it continued in operation till about 1852, when a flood on the Androscoggin River undermined it, and it fell into the river and went downstream. There was organized shortly after, in 1836, the old Lincoln Mill. The mill itself, the building itself, was not built until 1845, although the organization had been set up 9 years earlier. And that was prompted and promoted by local interests. This mill operated for a great many years and produced a profit and attracted the attention naturally of others who were interested in textile manufacturing. Consequently, Lewiston became the object of investigation by outside financial interests. And with the aid of the Little family, became, by the middle of the last century, a thriving and promising textile empire. Two things were particularly important in bringing textile mills to Lewiston on a large scale. First was the organization and completion of the Androscoggin and Kennebec Railroad, which ran from Danville Junction to Waterville, and at Danville connected with the Atlantic and St. Lawrence, which ran from Portland to Montreal. And the second important link in the chain of development was the building of the canals. It was a long, long process. It was promoted in the first place by the Little family, the canal proposition. When in 1836, that was incorporated the great Androscoggin Falls, Mills, Dams, and Canal Company. Well, that's kind of an awkward title, so in 1845 it was changed to the Lewiston Water Power Company. And immediately there was brought to Lewiston by the Littles an engineer from Boston to lay out the possibility of diverting the waters of the Androscoggin River into canals so along which manufacturing plants could be located. After a long series of surveys, in 1850, work was begun on the original canal, and by 1851 it went as far as the first cross canal as it exists today. Immediately, power in this volume was available. A group of financiers began the organization of the Bates Mill, named for Benjamin Bates. He was not only prominent in its management, but in his time the largest stockholder. Immediately after the canal was completed for the first section, the first Bates Mill, construction of the first Bates Mill was begun, was completed late in 1851 and went into operation in 1852. And immediately the first section was in operation, another section was built, Bates Mill number 2, along the same line as Bates Mill number 1, and along with the continuation of the construction of the canal. And then that followed shortly after the organization of the Hill Mill, also on the canal, and that went into operation in 1854. So that at a very early time, more than 100 years ago, the city of Lewiston became the textile capital of northern New England. To be sure, Lynn, Massachusetts, and some other Massachusetts communities were active in textile manufacturing. But with transportation available, and with power easily available from the waters of the canal, Lewiston very early became one of the most important textile centers in this country. Now, in order to produce the best results in the manufacturing of textile goods, few Americans were qualified to properly supervise the manufacture of cloth. Consequently, there were brought in English technicians that took over the supervision of the manufacturing, although the capital was provided by Americans. And thus it came about that aside from those of long-standing American residents, there grew up in Lewiston a group of new immigrants coming from England, mostly, to be sure, operators of textile machinery, some of them in the supervisory capacity. Of course, any community must have several possible angles to its life. In the first place, man must have a way to earn a livelihood. So Lewiston was turning away at that time from the work of farming and was becoming a manufacturing center, although agriculture was still of some importance. And having attained a livelihood, it became necessary for Lewiston settlers to figure some way to educate their children. Very little was done, of course, in the field of education for the early settlers. If you recall that Lewiston was first settled in 1770 with just a few families, and few of them of any academic training, there would be little opportunity indeed for any children of those families to secure more than the very rudiments of education in which their own parents might be to some extent skilled. But as we said 2 months ago, Amos Davis moved into Lewiston, a man of tremendous natural ability, of some education, and very early after he came here, he realized the necessity for active training, for actual training, mental training, for the children of those who were settled here. So the first school in Lewiston was constructed by him in what is the old Davis Cemetery upon Sabata Street, the corner of Sabata and Central Avenue, and was used both for a friend's meeting house and for a schoolhouse where one of his relatives, a Mrs. Potter, taught the first school in Lewiston. After the establishment of this school, schools were organized in other sections of the community, particularly in the southwestern section, in the homes. And teachers were brought across the river from the Poughkeepsie Claim in Danville for the most part, and kept school in homes, in the Gosselin home, in the Hodgkins home, even up here in Barker Mill, in the Herrick Tap. So that the beginning of education was already made in Lewiston before the town was incorporated in 1795. In 1795, upon the incorporation of Lewiston, with something like 400 residents, and a fairly large number of them children at that. Lewiston appropriated $250 at town meeting for purposes of education and authorized 7 school districts organized at the first town meeting to raise money to build schoolhouses. The first schoolhouse was built that very year in District Number 3 on West Rose Hill. And although even at that time, the Falls section of Lewiston had the larger population, it was the enterprising out-of-town farmers, so to speak, who saw to it that their children had the first schoolhouse. A schoolhouse was built in the Markham Mill area in 1796. That was in District Number 1. And the schoolhouse, first schoolhouse in Lewiston proper, in metropolitan Lewiston, should I say, was not built until 1804. There was some confusion about securing land, and finally Abner Harris, the son of Lawrence J. Harris, who had acquired the mill property from Colonel Moses Little, gave the lot and offered to build the schoolhouse himself if nobody else would do it, and the district, a little bit ashamed, raised the money and built Lewiston's first second district schoolhouse in 1804. There were 4 other Lewiston districts, one near Thorns Corner, one in the Goslin area in South Lewiston, out near No Name Pond, and one still further out near the, what is at present, the Sabattis Line, which of course then was the Little River Plantation Line of John Libby's town of Lisbon. During the very earliest existence of the town of Lewiston, the appropriations for education in comparison with other necessary municipal services were comparatively large, so that at a very early age, Lewiston built up a reputation of having fine schools. It would be impossible to follow down, nor would you be able to follow it any more than I would either. The growth of Lewiston school districts from the time of the incorporation of the town of Lewiston down to the passing of the town into the city, chartered, by the way, in 1861, but not set up as a city, municipal, as a city government until 1863. But perhaps it's enough to say this, that by 1860 there were 13 Lewiston school districts and 28 Lewiston schoolhouses. In District Number 2, which was metropolitan Lewiston, the area around the falls in that vicinity, there were 16 grade schoolhouses. So you can very well imagine that Lewiston citizens were extremely interested in the education of their families. And by the way, that makes me think, I can't give you the exact figures, but in round figures, the school population of Lewiston in 1860 was 2,600. Of those 2,600, 1,300 were listed as American. 721, and I remember that figure, were listed as Irish Americans. 128 was were listed as English Americans, and only 74 were interested as Franco-Americans, which certainly was very much of a surprise to me. There were a few Germans, there were likewise a few Swedes. So that by the time, when the time arrived for Lewiston to become a city, it already had 28 schoolhouses in operation. But the citizens of South Lewiston were not completely content with just the grade school education for their children. Particularly the Gosselin family, the Hodgkins family, the Carville family, and a few of those families that were the backbone of early South Lewiston. So in 1822, by subscription, they employed a graduate of Bowdoin College to teach in 3 months of higher school subjects in South Lewiston. The second year, the secondary school was in operation. It drew students from all over the city of Lewiston, the town of Lewiston. And it continued in to be operated by subscription until shortly after 1836, when the Lewiston Falls Academy was established and began classes over in the Danville area. And when there was a secondary school already within the area, many of the Lewiston students who wished to go on with secondary education came over and studied at the Lewiston Falls Academy. Lewiston's first high school was organized in 1850, first free high school. It was held in a wooden building up here on Main Street for a time, and then a brick building was built northeast of the present Lewiston Buick building, or Raytheon building, which of course has stood there for many years and which of course now has fallen before the onslaught of progress and prosperity, and the site is now a filling station. That was Lewiston's first high school, established in 1850. Before Lewiston became a city, it had a tremendous influence in military affairs in the state. Three citizens of Lewiston went off to the Revolutionary War, although the town, the first settlement of the town, had begun only 5 years before the war broke out. David and Benjamin Pettingill, father and son, and David Pettingill, incidentally, was the second permanent settler in Lewiston, went into the Revolutionary Army. David never came back. Benjamin Pettingill, however, did come back, and he left Lewiston and settled on the Minot side of the river, now Auburn. And Joel Thompson, who had settled in the No-Name Pond area, came back to find that somebody else had already gobbled up part of his property, and finally he made an accommodation with them, so they divided up the lot that he had originally started to clear for himself. a considerable number of Revolutionary War veterans followed down through the years and settled in Lewiston, and then came the War of 1812. By 1812, Lewiston had a population of about 1,100. It raised two companies of militia to serve in the War of 1812. Captain Oliver Herrick, whose father had established what was supposed to be the first public house in the city of Lewiston, commanded one company which left Lewiston, went to the Champlain, Lake Champlain area, was ordered aboard the American ship Growler, which, if you remember, was captured by a British ship on the lake. A disastrous campaign, and a considerable number of Lewiston soldiers spent time as prisoners of war in Quebec. The second Lewiston Company was organized in 1813 and was sent to the coast in anticipation of a British attack on Bath or up the Kennebec River. And they camped for about 3 weeks in what was later the town of Pittston. There were no, so far as I can determine, no Lewiston veterans of the Mexican War, which of course was fought by the United States Regular Army. But before Lewiston became a city, the Civil War had broken out. In April 1861, when Fort Sumter was fired upon, Governor Washburn of Maine immediately called for volunteers to organize Maine regiments to go to the defense of Washington. And the company, Lewiston Company, commanded by J.N. Jackson, who had considerable military experience in the old militia, was the first company in the state of Maine to offer its services to Governor Washburn. Services, of course, which were accepted. They were sent to Portland, became a company of the 1st Maine Regiment of Infantry, and Captain Jackson became the colonel of the 1st Maine Regiment of Infantry. But no sooner had he arrived in Portland when a second company of Lewiston volunteers arrived in Portland too. And they, too, were incorporated into the 1st Maine Regiment, which had 10 companies, so that one-fifth of the 1st Maine Regiment were from the Lewiston area and commanded by a Lewiston military man.